science portrays that our corner of the universe is nothing special. At the heart of the assumption lies the Copernican principle, which states that humans on Earth are not privileged observers of the universe. Not only is our solar system highly unusual, but our Sun is not a run-of-the-mill star. It is a yellow dwarf star, which you may think, together with white dwarf stars, should be common elsewhere, but unfortunately this is not the case at all. And instead, red dwarf stars are by far the most common star in the Milky Way, and they present some rather large problems referred to as the red sky paradox. Most stars in the universe are red dwarf stars. They outnumber stars like our Sun by a factor of 5. According to mainstream astronomy, these stars also last about 20 times longer in comparison to our star. This means that none have reached the end of their main sequence lifespan during the assumed age of the universe. Here I must caveat both of those, as there is a different way of looking at this problem, which we will explore in a little while. So let's return to the red sky paradox. If red dwarf stars are the most common star and are also so stable, we should also not consider ourselves to be special. The very fact that we are not orbiting a red dwarf star, but instead the not so common yellow dwarf, and yet we have not found any other forms of intelligent life elsewhere in the universe. This presents rather an interesting problem that is dubbed the red sky paradox. A new paper attempts to examine this in more detail, as solving this paradox may provide guidance for targeting future remote life-sensing experiments. Red dwarf stars are an attractive prospect for the search for extraterrestrial life. They emit less energy in comparison to our Sun, which would mean any planets orbiting them would need to be closer to the star in order to reach the habitable temperatures. In the paper, the author outlines 4 possible solutions to the red sky paradox. Resolution 1. An unusual outcome. The first possibility postulates that nothing is different about the emergence of intelligence between yellow dwarf stars and red dwarf stars. We are simply an unusual member by finding ourselves around a yellow dwarf star. If the rate at which life emerges around both types of stars is similar, then Earth is an outlier with a 100-to-1 chance of forming. This does, however, create tension with the Copernican principle. Resolution 2. Inhibited life under red sky. Here, the idea is that red dwarf stars create environments that are not supportive of life compared to yellow dwarf stars. Consequently, life evolved far less often around red dwarf stars. They estimate that this could be as much as 100 times less likely. We know that red dwarf stars have the highest flare rate of any star type, and because the planets would need to be much closer to the star due to the low output from these types of stars, it puts any planet in the firing line of these massive superflares. Resolution 3. A truncated window for complex life. The concept here is that life has not had enough time to emerge around red dwarf stars. The reasoning for this is that terrestrial worlds forming in the main sequence habitable zone of red dwarf stars will be subject to an initial phase of higher radiance, potentially pushing them into a runaway greenhouse state that persists even after this phase is over. Resolution 4. A paucity of pale red dots. Here, the idea is that planets forming around red dwarfs may be more uncommon, especially in the habitable zone compared to yellow dwarf stars. Currently, around 16% of red dwarfs have exoplanets that are rocky, but maybe this is not the norm. These surveys sample the most massive and brightest red dwarfs, but what if the smaller ones, of which we know very little, don't have any rocky planets in their habitable zone? Since the low-mass red dwarfs are the most common, this could mean that the habitable zone rocky exoplanets are 100 times less common around red dwarf stars in comparison to yellow dwarfs. In this case, intelligent life is rare amongst the cosmos and spawns universally between red dwarfs and yellow dwarf stars. This would mean that the vast majority of known Earth-sized temperate planets around red dwarf stars are somehow inhospitable to life, or that they rarely host habitable worlds. Now, there are some immediate questions that this research raises. Firstly, why are red dwarf stars so much more common than yellow dwarf stars? The mainstream explanation here is that they are so small and have such low mass, they evolve very slowly. An estimation puts their main sequence lifetime at 100 billion years. This, they claim, is why there are many red dwarfs. Bigger stars come and go as slowly the number of red dwarf stars grows and grows. In the electric universe, stars are not thermonuclear, but instead are electrically powered. So if this is the case, why would we see more red dwarf stars than yellow dwarf stars? The assumption is that the type of star is not determined by what stage it is on the mainstream's idea of the evolution of a star. Instead, it is determined by the electrical input and the environment the star resides in. Red dwarf stars are just receiving a lower input compared to a yellow dwarf star, which in turn receives less compared to a blue star. As the input changes, it can cause a star to change from a red star all the way up to a blue star. Observations show that stars do seem to undergo sudden changes after brightening events. So why would we see more red dwarf stars in the electric universe? I see that there are three different ways of explaining this. The first, stars form in pinches along filaments. Research shows that these stars can be ejected from the central filament. I have done a separate video on the slingshot mechanism, which you can find on my channel See the Pattern. This means that as stars are initially born at the heart of the filament, they start near the highest current density and will burn bright blue. Depending on the kick they gain from the filament, they will slowly start to move further away from the central axis, where the current density steadily decreases, meaning they will become redder in colour. The second option. Although most stars are created close to the centre of the filament itself is not stationary and could move slowly over time. This means that most stars will not end up being close to the centre, and over time, as it migrates, more stars would have reduced current density due to their location. And lastly, high-powered stars are more likely to experience electrical stressing. In simple terms, this means that the incoming current is too great for the surface area of the star to be able to deal with. There is a significant excess of charge. In some cases, this can lead to the star splitting in two, a process referred to as fissioning. The two smaller stars would end up with a greater combined surface area to deal with a current. This process could also impart a kick to either one or both of the stars, once more leading to it moving further away from the highest current density location of the filament. It is also possible that a combination of these factors is at play rather than just a single one. The next question is the question of where intelligent life is likely to develop. Here, it is interesting to point out that the article only focuses on the contrast between a yellow dwarf and a red dwarf star. What about the other star types? Larger and brighter stars are probably less hospitable, but what about the cooler stars? If we examine round dwarf stars, you will quickly realise that these are just as common, if not more common, in our Milky Way. The problem until recently has been detecting them, as they are even fainter than red dwarf stars. But new studies reveal that the Milky Way is filled with brown dwarf stars. Again here, the three possible reasons I outlined for red dwarf stars would equally work for explaining why brown dwarf stars are more common than yellow dwarf stars. But surely life could not survive around a brown dwarf star. They are cooler and smaller than red dwarf stars, but also seem to show strong flaring events. This is often how they are actually detected. Certainly, if you look at the Goldilocks zone, which is where they consider life to be habitable around a star, this is almost on top of the star itself. At first glance, this would appear to be a non-starter. But the assumption here is that life starts on the planet. Brown dwarfs are similar to our gas giants, and now scientists have suggested that life could survive in the upper layers of a brown dwarf atmosphere, which have temperatures and pressures similar to Earth's. This could then provide a springboard for life to migrate to the planets that could have been ejected from the star. Is it possible that planets and life could exist within the plasma sheath of a brown dwarf? This is not something that I have investigated yet, but it is one of the electric universe theories that the Earth was once part of Saturn, which at the time was a brown dwarf star. Within the envelope, could life evolve, and would this hide their existence from our view? Could this be a different way of explaining why we have not discovered life elsewhere? There are many open questions this concept raises that are worth considering further.